as I said, for me it was quite important to see that we can bring the climate change into the issue of environmental, of structural and cohesion funds, and the work that we've been doing for 9 years now on the cohesion policy. If I can refer to what Mr. Ginter-Rath mentioned in his speech a moment ago, I think environmental NGOs have been seeing the forest and not only the trees. We've been seeing why we have to deal with it. And I do hope that this conference will also underline that the issue of climate is an issue that we all need to look at. At this note, I would like to pass on to Mrs. Hubner as a first speaker. Maybe a short introduction. Ms. Danuta Hubner is a chairwoman of the Committee on Regional Development and the former commissioner on regional development, so definitely a person with a lot of experience in the issue. Elisabeth Schroedter is a chairwoman of a social and employment committee, but also a member of the regional development committee, and someone who's been dealing with EU funds since I remember, so the last 9 years, and I guess much longer.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you also very much for raising all those issues, because Elisabeth, we are members of the same REGI committee, and we know that this is the right moment to talk about the link between the climate policy and the cohesion policy. Actually, climate policy and all European policies, but here we will focus on this policy. I'm saying this because I believe that neither the climate change nor the cohesion policy can be disconnected from the crisis. So this is the moment really to see the links, the interdependencies, because European climate policy should guide us through the transition to a low carbon economy. But it's also providing growth opportunities for all the innovative sectors, technologies, and companies. And it is also clear that this process cannot come without a cost, and what is even more important, without a structural adjustment. And that is why exactly we need strategies and we need policies. This will not just happen. This has to be strategically planned, and this also has to pass through a careful design of policies and good implementation of the policies. But of course, in the context of climate change impact on growth, a legitimate question is also asked in Europe, what kind of growth is desirable? And that's, I understand, where you come also with your views, with your ideas on sustainable growth that Europe will need in the future. And there are also very convincing studies, and you probably discussed also some of them here, that clearly show that benefits of strong and also early action on the climate change in Europe outweigh economic costs of non-action. So I think it is, I'm saying this because for some of us, it's probably obvious, but for many people, this background, this context is extremely important to understand what is the challenge, what is at stake, and how important it is today to see that the European climate policy is designed in such a way that it can guide us safely through this period of deep structural change, and that at the end we can, or throughout the process as well, we can have growth that would be sustainable. It is also important to discuss this today because the crisis has also triggered a huge, I would say, fiscal stimulus to relaunch growth. A lot of billions and trillions, if you include banks, of euros and dollars were pumped into our economies. So it is also legitimate to ask today whether these packages, they are targeted towards low carbon investment. And if they were, then I think we could say that we are moving towards this new growth paradigm where sustainability is integrated into the core growth objective. That's why this crisis, anti-crisis policy, the big challenge of sustainability and climate change and the strategies and policies for the post-crisis period. All that is in fact one big package which is with desires, reflection, and I would rather say prompt action or action in general. And of course here comes the cohesion policy, because cohesion policy is an investment policy. So it is a policy which has this long-term direction and which has also a history of shifting investment patterns. Because even if we talk about the European budget, which is just 1% of the European GDP, and if we talk about the cohesion policy budget, which is 1/3 more or less of this European budget, it looks like it's a sort of nearly statistical error if you think in global terms. But for many areas, for many regions, for many cities, this is very often the major source of public investment. Sometimes it's the only source locally or regionally of public investment. And that's why the impact on investment patterns of this policy can be very, very important and decisive. That's why the cohesion policy also has to be seen through this perspective of how it, what type of growth it is to generate, it is going to generate in the future. And I would also like to say that we are, with the cohesion policy and its focus on climate change related investment or priorities, this is something which this policy is not just about to start or to start in the future from scratch, because in fact for 2007-2013, if some of you might recall the negotiations of the guidelines for the European guidelines for this policy in 2005 and then national programs, among the priorities we had very clearly, very strongly, sustainable development. We had embarked on the strategic impact assessment exercise and also environmental impact assessment, which all those new instruments were supposed to integrate sustainability into the infrastructure projects financed by the cohesion policy. The green public procurement, which also exists probably still far too often on paper mostly, but it is already there as a potential framework which requires a stronger commitment in terms of the implementation. We also, in 2007-13, among those priorities, we have put emphasis on sustainable urban transport long before the transport policy has launched its green paper or this first document on the sustainable urban transport. So the policy has in practical terms introduced many objectives, including energy efficiency, renewables, into the policy priorities for 2007-13. I know that we have not introduced the notion of ecological capital, but in fact we made, I think, the first steps in this direction. But my strong conviction is that climate-proof growth will not occur in Europe without really engagement of regional and local development actors. I am in fact convinced, and this I also base on experience I managed to be in most of European regions, and I could see that without making regions and cities active partners in climate change, post-adaptation and mitigation efforts, Europe will simply not succeed on this front. And subnational efforts are really badly needed alongside the national and European efforts in this area. I would say that maybe paradoxically, but I'm not sure it's a paradox, but the more global the challenge, the more important it is that we have the local responses integrated, incorporated into the response. Otherwise, we will not be neither effective nor efficient.